So our next session, I think, will be an extremely exciting one. And for those of you who saw or followed Zurich, it was a session that was started there, and it's called Women Up. And I think, just a couple of words of background. I mean, I think it's an incredibly important session to end the day on. I have seen, probably the person in the world most responsible for the success I've been able to have in my career, other than my wife, is Kate Robertson. Kate doesn't have the same ride I have in the world of business. I see her run into obstacles because she's a woman that I don't run into. You know, the smartest person I know in the world is my sister. You know, she didn't have as easy a time in the world of business as I've had because, from a gender perspective, I have two amazing daughters, Agathe and Apolline. I would like them to come into a world where they don't have any barriers facing them and they can be every bit as successful as my sons can be. And I think there was a wonderful quote, which to me was still the quote of the whole of One Young World last year, when Christine Ockrent, the first ever female TV news anchor in France, said, "Women will have true equality with men in business when a clearly incompetent woman can still get the top job." And I thought it was just an absolutely brilliant way of nailing it. So against that backdrop, and I think really importantly as well, against a backdrop of, you know, what's the amazing thing about having 183 countries in the room is every single issue we can talk about means often dramatically different things to different people. So in the Western world, equal rights for women is much more about equal pay and no glass ceilings and equal opportunities. Whereas, as we've heard already today, in many parts of the world, it's about if as a woman you speak out, someone comes and tries to kill you. And so it's a very broad and diverse subject and a very complex subject. But I'm absolutely delighted to welcome to the stage two people who did such a fantastic job for us before on Women Up. It's Adeline Brescu-Carlin and Emmanuel Duez, who are One Young World ambassadors. They created Women Up to promote gender equality, and they've engaged with many of the world's companies to get them on board with this. The results of what they've done are hugely impressive, and I would love to welcome them to the stage now.
Thank you, Kate and David, for this introduction. Hello to all of you. As some of you may know, this is the second edition of the Women Up special session. And today, Kate and David upgraded the level of difficulty because we are not only standing in front of 1,200 people, we're standing between 1,200 empty stomachs and dinner. So we'll make sure it goes very smoothly. Today, the Women Up session is going to be about female leadership. And today, we are very lucky because we have four counselors who embody, each of them, a very special characteristic of female leadership. We can go as far as to say, as together, their qualities could be what would perfect female leadership look like. So without further delay, we'll welcome on the stage our counselors. They all look like supermodels. They also have super brains, they have super energy, and they're super inspiring. So you got it correctly. Today the session is all about super heroines.
So please, welcome on stage super writer
Fatima Bouteau.
Super networker
Carol Stone.
Super beauty
Natalia Vodianova.
And super enterprise leader
Caroline Miles. So before we get started, I'll just take a few words to explain you how the session will go this time. First, we are going to start with a presentation of an association called Women Up that Emmanuel and I and 14 other people in France have been working over for the last 2 years. There's nothing heroical about it. Just a lot of day-to-day work, a lot of passion, and an all-time dedication to our team. And that's why with Emmanuel tonight, we will be referred to as super teammates from now on. Second, we'll have an heroic session with the counselors and we'll have a lot of questions asked to them. And lastly, we'll have the great chance to hear from a last counselor who's going to be very inspiring. But let's start with a presentation of Women Up.
Women Up. The first question I would like to answer is, what is Women Up? Women Up is an association that deals with a triptych, Y generation, networking, and gender diversity. It's the first French association dedicated to this crucial issue of gender diversity in the workplace with a Y generation perspective. Women Up is an action based on a conviction, but first of all, it's a fabulous human success story. 3 years ago, Aline and I met at the ESSEC Diversity and Leadership Share. We worked together for Deloitte on this interesting issue of female leadership. We liked it. We liked the subject and we liked working together. 3 years after, Women Up is a big machine. 15 people working every day to transform a dream into concrete actions. 15 international companies joining the adventure. A club of 50 students particularly engaged, working with our partner companies to transform their internal policies into more sustainable ones. 5,000 people directly impacted by our actions. And if we had our media coverage, it's more than 1 million people aware of Women Up actions. But before the action, there is a very deep conviction, which is the source of our inspiration. Our generation, the Y generation, has the power to change gender, to achieve gender diversity in the workplace. Why? Because we are the first generation where both boys and girls share, assume, and claim the same expectations in terms of work-life balance. They ask companies to respect their private life. They are convinced that the key of happiness is a good balance between professional and personal areas. They want companies to become places of professional fulfillment, and they want to be respected as individuals in order to be more engaged, more motivated, and then more efficient. If they don't find this, they are more likely to quit. And this is what we call the Y revolution, because if young men are looking for a good work-life balance, which is nothing but one of the main feminist demands of the last 20 years, that means gender diversity is no longer a female issue. It deals with the expectation of an entire generation. And this changes everything. For companies, providing a good work-life balance becomes a key business tool in order to attract and retain the best talents of our generation. And it's no longer about ideology. It's about creating a competitive advantage. Here we have the famous business case companies are looking for. Without BKs, no real evolution can be achieved in the workplace, but with a BKs, everything becomes possible.
And that's why we decided to act on two levels. First, we chose to organize massive sensitization towards Gen Y people so that they understand the superpowers that they have in themselves to finally achieve gender equality in the workplace. And second, we act in a very concrete way. We design targeted actions that involve both Gen Y people and firms to truly have an impact on the firm's policies. In order to maintain and to maximize our impact, we use the tools, the codes and the power of our generation to convey new and very positive messages about gender equality. And here are four of the things that we do. First, what we do is fun. Obviously, you saw it. Gender equality is not a boring subject. And we think that fun can sometimes have a much stronger impact on people than catastrophism. So for instance, last year we organized a symposium called How the New Kens and Barbies Will Conquer the World that seduced Gen Y people but also CEOs of big companies, and that was actually a perfect occasion to speak about very important subject but on a fun tone. Second, we propose the companies to change their views on gender equality, and that's why we involve them every step of the way and we work hand in hand with the corporation. Third, we work on the content, and we just come back from the Women's Forum where we have been presenting a study that we ran with the auditing firm Mazar that was about more than 1,000 Gen Y people in 64 countries, and we asked them what were their views on gender equality. So if you want to know more about this, we'll be happy to share it at the end of the session. And fourth, and that's very important, we know how to be serious when we have to, and that's why as often as we came, we talk to leaders and opinion makers.
The objective of this first phase of sensitization is to raise the awareness among the Y generation. Yes, gender diversity is still a big issue within organization. But yes, as a Y-er, I have the power to change things. I can transform myself from a spectator to an actor. And this is the objective of our second phase. We have created a club that puts together proactive companies and committed wires. Together, they work during 6 months at two different levels. Each month, companies and students meet for a conference around an inspiring guest. The idea of this cycle of conferences is double: to enhance companies and students to think differently, to think out of the box, to stimulate their creativity. But at the same time, these conferences are a privileged moment where students and companies can create links among each other. Indeed, we are absolutely convinced at WomenUp that the networking, that means the creation of links within organization, is a key professional competency to successfully manage a career, a competency young people have to acquire and develop as soon as possible. The second step of action is also very concrete and deals with business projects focused on gender diversity. Our partner companies design and propose this project according to their internal issues. During 6 months, students work on this project on their free time. Our objective is to create a win-win relationship. Students have the amazing opportunity to understand everything about gender diversity, and this at the early stage of their professional life, and to create a network within the companies that fits their professional expectations. On the other side, companies have the amazing opportunity to understand everything about this new generation's expectations, to benefit from a fresh, external and creative look on their internal issues, and to develop a new pool of talent. For instance, last year, the club has implemented a female network, has contributed to the realization of a qualitative survey about the internal perception of gender diversity policies, and has realized a video about the measurement of diversity, and so on. So to conclude, last year, we went here in front of you, and we committed to develop our action. We are very proud to announce you that we have overperformed. Among this objective, there was the involvement of men from the conception to the implementation of our actions. Last year, Idriss was on stage to give you his male point of view. Let me introduce you to Jonathan, who is a new WomenUp team member and who is going to tell you why gender diversity is, first of all, a main issue.
La petite musique.
Hello, everyone. Hello, One Young World. So thanks for having me here first. So I'm gonna tell you how they just asked me to be part of their organization. And so when they came in the first place, Adeline and Emmanuel asked me to be a speaker for One Young World session. And they told me that my mission was to convince young men that they have a role to play for gender equality at the workplace in 2 minutes. So I just said, wow, what a tough mission. So how am I gonna do that? First, when I met them, that was in our school, ESSEC, and they came to present that organization, Women App, to diversity and leadership chair students, and we were part of it. So at that time, as a chair student, I had to get involved in like in a project, in an organization, and I choose One Up. Why? Because what they said to me at the time, it just made perfect sense. So first, the message and what they convey that makes sense for men, and particularly young men, the one that are part of the Y generation, as I said before. So it makes sense because young men and women, we do all have the same expectation about lives. So we are thinking alike and sharing the same wants and needs, especially when it comes to our private life and professional life. So we are thinking a lot about the relationship between both, and our ambitions are as employees of a company are no longer the same, no longer what they used to be for previous generation, because we are different. So we have the same ambition no matter what is our gender. So we are looking for a work-life balance. We are real entrepreneurs, that is to say that we are entrepreneurs of our own path within a company. And then we are expecting from a job that lead to our self-fulfillment. So basically what we have in common, whether you are man or woman, it's that we are addressing the nature of leadership itself. So, I mean, each and every one of us, we're trying to define what is leadership today, and we are trying to establish a new definition. So, we are trying to figure out whether it could encompass one or several meanings. So, first, we don't want to be isolated leaders, so we are all experiencers, and meaning that we like to share ideas and to create desire around projects. Secondly, we like to motivate and being motivated because we like to share. So for us, teamworking is valued a lot and trust is a must. So finally, we're not that much into processes. So we need more room for intuition and creativity because we think that it will foster innovation, simply. So women leaders have tried to put it forward, they tried to put forward those ideas for ages, but they did not succeed because it was dominated by another model. So, but now that we have a community of interests, wires, as we call them, so we believe we can't achieve great things unless we share different point of views, unless we bring actual diversity at the workplace. So we can make a difference. And so what I would say, this is your chance to make a difference and your own interest to get involved in such an organization and in this great cause. So do it, be superheroes as well as all of those wonderful speakers today. And I'm really proud of you girls, of your achievements and your enthusiasm. So thank you and thank you all.
Thank you, Jonathan. Thank you, our boy, to have been there. And now enough with Gen Y people. And let's turn to the counselors. And we're going to start by Fatima. Fatima, everyone knows you because you were on the stage this morning, obviously. Everyone has had a hint of how good a speaker you are. And we chose you to be our super writer today because you know more than anyone how the words have a power, whether they are written or spoken. So we have a few questions for you, but to be honest, when you have to ask a question to a superheroine, one needs a superhero. And to be honest, superheroes are not very easy to find those days. But we're really happy to have four of them who will be on videos and who will be the interviewers today. So super writer, we believe that Batman has a question for you.
Peut-on changer le monde avec les mots? Et dans quelle mesure votre héritage familial joue un rôle dans le combat public que vous menez aujourd'hui? Thank you. Hi, I'm Sylvain from Canada. I'm a PR manager.
Okay, well, it's Batman, so I'll get up. So the first question was, can words save the world? No. No, the answer is no. And before you all get grumpy and side with Batman, I'll tell you why I say no. And there's several reasons. The first is that one would have to have an extraordinarily grand sense of self to believe that that were true. The idea is not only flawed, but it's arrogant. To think that one group of people or one set of actions alone can save the world or can save anything is mistaken. And it's mistaken because the truth of the world and the secret of the universe and things that we keep hearing at One Young World today, what we kept hearing last year, is that we are all connected. Everything is connected. Everything is connected and every one of us is connected. The idea is wrong, and I say no as well because it's dangerous. And it's dangerous because who decides which words help save the world and who decides which words hurt the world? And the best example I can give you of why it's dangerous is Radovan Karadžić. You all are obviously aware that as we sit here today, Karadžić, the architect of the Bosnian War, a war that killed, I think conservative estimates say 100,000 people, is currently standing trial at The Hague for an assortment of crimes. And those crimes include ethnic cleansing, crimes against humanity, genocide, that sort of thing. But what you may not know, and actually what I hope you don't know, is that Karadžić is also a most prolific author. He has published 6 volumes of poetry. That's 6 books of poetry. He's written countless poems. They're available online. I don't recommend at all that you read any of them. But I can tell you this. Radovan Karadžić thinks that his writing is saving the world. When Karadžić writes, he writes to save the world. He writes with the belief that his words are saving the world. So, to answer Batman, please don't write to save the world. Write to break barriers, write to destroy boundaries, write to push for peace, write to spread compassion, but don't write to save the world. And I've sort of been wanting to say this for a while as well. I think it's connected. What do you call yourself One Young Worlders or One Young Worldies or One Young Worldians? Oh, that's much nicer. Okay, so One Young World Ambassadors, if we can say something to you, I feel like I should say this. Don't be the UN. Please don't be the United Nations. Because, oh good, I'm very pleased. Everyone's looking at me grumpily, but don't be the United Nations because the United Nations exists supposedly to save the world, and all it does is sanction war and protect the strong against the weak. So don't be them, but be what Bob said last night. Make hives, become hives. Everything is connected, and the sooner that all of us realize that and understand that and live and act with that mantra, then I think, yeah, we have a chance of saving something. The second question that Batman had was about me, but I think in the current scheme of things, it would be sort of obscene to talk about myself. When we all met last night, when One Young World kicked off yesterday evening, Kate said to us that there's one name that should be on our minds and one name that should be on our mouths and everywhere with us this week, and that's Malala. Malala Yousafzai, and I think I'd rather answer that question by talking about her. And if you were here in the morning, have all of you been here since 8 in the morning? That's amazing. So, So yes, big cheer. So you were here in the morning, and we spoke about it briefly, and I talked to you a tiny bit about context. And I want to talk a little more about that context. To do that, I've got to jump you back 5 years and take you to about 2007. It was about that time that the Pakistani Taliban began their takeover of the Swat Valley. So about 5 years ago, they kicked out polio eradication campaigns from the valley. They burnt down schools. They cut access to cable television. And they changed radio broadcasts, which they believed were un-Islamic, to only push for one agenda. This was a slow process. This was a long process. It didn't come out of thin air. It was not a surprise. And all the while that it was happening, the Pakistani state did nothing. I mean, actively, it did nothing. So it did not insist on polio eradication drives. It did not rebuild schools that had been burnt down. It did not demand that broadcasters present balanced information to audiences. It did nothing. And in 2009, the Taliban declared their final intention, and they demanded that Sharia law be imposed in the Swat Valley. To that, the Pakistani state said, well, of course, sure, whatever you'd like. And the National Assembly in 2009, the very same National Assembly that is currently sitting, drafted a bill. They drafted a bill to institute Sharia law in the Swat Valley, and they called the bill, this is the Pakistani state's wording, the Order of Justice. They drafted the bill, and the president, again, the very same president that sits there right now, signed that bill into law on April 13th, I think, 2009. Not only they signed it into law, but they had it start retroactively. A couple months later, the state changed its mind and it went to war. And it's this point in time that a seventh grade girl, only 11 years old at the time, begins to write a blog for the BBC. Have you read Malala's diary? Have many of you read? So Malala wrote, and she wrote about the nightmare of military helicopters constantly flying overhead. She wrote about girls dropping out of schools, and the girls who stayed, she wrote about how they came to school dressed in their normal clothes and not in their uniform so that they wouldn't be targeted. And Malala wrote under a pen name. She called herself Gul Makai, which she said she liked a lot more than her real name, Malala, which means grief-stricken. Context. The week after Malala was shot, 16 Pakistanis were killed by an unmanned predator drone strike. That violence came at the hand of fundamentalists too. Different fundamentalists, but fundamentalists all the same. This week, while we've all been here together in Pittsburgh, 3 children in Afghanistan were killed by a NATO artillery strike. Tragic, said NATO after the killing, but NATO answered the killing of 3 children with a but. And I think the point I'm trying to make here is the same that I made a minute ago. Everything is connected. Malala shooting, those 16 deaths by drone strike, those 3 children killed in the artillery strike. There's no difference. When you sanction violence, you cannot decide who uses it. When you employ violence, you cannot restrict others from using it. Violence is unacceptable, no matter who the perpetrator is. And if I can end, I want to end with something Malala herself said. She did a CNN interview in 2011, which you may have seen. And if you haven't seen it, please go home and YouTube it. The interview is extraordinary, not only because the interviewer asks like ridiculous questions, but as ridiculous as his questions were, Malala's answers were clear and eloquent and brave. And he asks her at some point what she would say to all the other girls. What would she say to all the other 14-year-olds who are scared and who just want to stay home and lock the door and not think about it? This, I think, should be the answer to this, to Batman's question. Malala said, without missing a beat, she said that she would tell them, don't be afraid. Your people are being blown up. Stand up for their rights. So let's end with Malala. Thank you.
So thank you, Fatima, and thank you for reminding us that the situation of women is indeed very different in all the parts of the world. So to go back to business, because it also happens, we're now going to turn to another type of superpower. And I feel a bit stupid saying that now, but we'll still go on with the roundtable with Malala in mind. This other power is networking. And when it comes to networking, most of the time, women are not as good as men. And we have the perfect example of a woman who knows everything about that. So Carol Stone, who used to be a journalist at the BBC and who's famous in Great Britain as the queen of networking, is going to tell us more about that. And we also have a superhero asking her the question. But as networking is most of the time perceived as a negative thing, our superhero is Darth Vader.
Lucy, China.
Well, what can you say to that? I quite agree that bad networking is not good, but remember that Ethan Darth Vader, in the end, chose to be good, and you still have time to be good networkers. And good networkers are those that make the most of the people they meet to their mutual advantage. There's nothing wrong in networking. It will help your career, whether you're a woman or a man. And I think women are as good networkers as men even now. But networking can really make a difference to your personal and your professional life. And if I'd known at your age what I know now, I would say to you, start now to collect the people that interest you and the people that you want to keep in touch with, including the people you meet at this summit here for One Young World, because it is by choosing those people that you are defined by the people that you and the company that you keep. You are lucky enough to be defined by the company you keep, and you can choose them. That's the wonderful thing. So I say that in order to be good in your career or in your personal life, you have to be strong within yourself. After what Fatima said, what I'm saying is nowhere near as deep or as important in many ways, but I do believe that having confidence in yourself and speaking to other people, taking an interest in other people, really is life-changing stuff. So I would say, have that confidence. Don't worry about failure. Don't worry about snubs. I was snubbed just the other day at a breakfast. A woman sat next to me and then saw somebody more interested and moved away. And I was quite unhappy for about 5 minutes. And then I thought, well, what does it matter? I'm not going to marry the woman. What does it matter? And I got over it. And I think that once you've got the, if you go into a room and think, I'm here now, what's the worst that can happen? Is I can be snubbed, or I can leave without talking to somebody. So make sure that you do talk to somebody, because in life, it's often the things you don't do that you regret more than the things that you do do and that you fail at. Now, a lot of people say to me, say, oh, well, Carol, it's all right for you. You've got an outgoing personality. You're quite bubbly. You're quite effervescent. But I was born and grew up very, very shy. I had a brother who was even shyer than me. He was 2 years older. And in his 20s, he was developed or known to be suffering from paranoid schizophrenia. And he died of a stroke in his 40s. And Roger's legend, my brother's legend to me, was to reach out and communicate with other people. I was shy because you can't see up here, thank goodness, but I've got very small boobs. And I've got a very big nose. Just think, if that had been the other way around, life could have been very different. So, I just say, really, to take life by the scruff of the neck, to look round the next corner, and above all, to be ever curious, but never, ever jealous, because that destroys you more than anyone else. and to live in the present, to live in the now. Obviously have good memories, maybe you have bad memories, and you have things that you might look forward to, or even some things you're dreading. But on the whole, nothing is ever quite as bad or quite as good as you're expecting. But live in the now. You're here now and think, oh, I could be doing this, I could be having dinner, whatever it is, get the full value out of what you're doing. Because I think that very, very much is a very important thing in life. Just to give you a little background, I joined the BBC when I was 21 as a copy typist, and they said to me, in 2 years' time, when you're 23, you will then be established staff and can have a career at the BBC and really be on your track to that career we're talking about. No worry for me, I thought. In 2 years' time, I'll be married and well on the way to having my family. It was to be 36 years before any man asked me to marry him. When I was 57, he asked me, I said yes immediately. He says gratefully. That was 13 years ago. I'm 70 now, and I can tell you I'm not going to waste any... I'm not going to waste any time being married wishing I was single, because I wasted too much time single wishing I was married. So I really do think you have to live by that. So all I can say really is that I feel that it is so, so important, as I say, to live in the now, to feel that you can do things and that you can stretch your potential. I think it is really, really wrong to go through your life, living life in little teeny sips, take great big gulps. You may spit some out, but at least you've had a go. And I think if I saw you again next year, and some of you maybe will be here next year, I'd just love to know that you've had a go, because you never know what's going to happen. That's the wonderful thing about networking. I haven't got much time, so I'm going to go on to the second thing, is my tips. My tips are, give yourself a time limit. Go into a room, into a conference, wherever you're going, and think, I can be out of here in half an hour, but you're not going to leave until you maybe have a card or two. If you're very shy, pick up two glasses of wine or two glasses of water, walk around with two glasses, and after a few minutes say, I just have to go and deliver the other one to somebody. It's a wonderful way for getting away from somebody. But don't ever do the dirty on them. Don't ever say, leave someone stranded, because they'll do the same to you. Either take them with you to that other person, or quickly introduce them to somebody else, and then you know that you can actually leave that person well. I think it was it Sujit Lalwani who said this morning, not human beings, but human doings. I think he's right. I think it is doing things that matter, trying new things. That's the really, really important thing. And also, you see so many people, it's the attitude to life you have. We know that things touch people, as bereavement touches people, sadness, illness, and happy things. It's how you react to what life throws at you. It's so important. I've got a good friend, Audrey. 10 years ago, her son hanged himself. I rang her every day for a year to look after her and to make sure she was fine. I thought I was a good friend. 5, 6, 7 years later, she had a book published or accepted. I've had two books accepted. And she said to me, Carol, she said, I've got an advance on my second book. I said, well done, Audrey. I got £1,000 on my first book and £3,000 advance on my second book. How much did you get, says I. $250,000, she said. It took every ounce of friendship to say, well done, Audrey. And I think people forget that often it's very difficult to know who you can share your triumphs with, who you can say, I was successful here or successful there. My girlfriend, I know, would be much happier if I said to her, my husband snores, I've put on weight, and I really, really, really don't think I can cope much longer. Much happier than saying, I've lost weight, I've got a wonderful husband. People can't help but compare themselves to other people. Some say that happiness is feeling you're doing just that little bit better than somebody you know. So I want to say, network, take an interest in people, listen to them, ask them questions. It's flattering for them, but networking in the true good sense, which means looking at every person as someone who's got something in them that maybe you can help them by being generous with your contacts, I think can really change your career and change your life. Please do it.
So
Thank you very much, Carol. Guys, we're very close to the biggest networking session of your life, so just hold on a few minutes more. What we can take really from Fatima and Carol is above super writing and super networking skills, obviously they're also super passionate about what they do. And now we're going to turn to another subject, when we deal about female leadership, and this is kind of a taboo subject. When we talk about female leadership, there's something we rarely talk about, and this is beauty, and this is our feminine side, and what do we do with it wherever we come from in the world? And we could not find a better person to tell about this subject than Natalia Vodianova, supermodel, mother of three children, and also the founder of the Naked Heart Foundation. So Natalia, we have had someone very special who has a question for you.
Bonjour Natalia. Est-ce que la beauté est un atout pour gérer une carrière au féminin? Mais est-ce que c'est pas aussi un frein parce qu'on vous regarde juste pour votre beauté et pas pour ce que vous êtes vraiment? Par exemple, moi, Shrek, qui suis plutôt moche, est-ce que je pourrais réussir, pourquoi pas, dans le mannequinat? Et surtout, would you like to marry me? Je suis Cyril de France.
I feel I have to get up now. Okay, I have to get up. It's really hard to follow the speeches of these wonderful ladies, and I feel I should share this topic with Fatima at least. And it's really, I think that beauty, external beauty, is really, it is a sensitive subject for me especially. I actually grew up thinking that I'm really not pretty at all. I grew up thinking I'm even worse than average, because I was super tall, very skinny, and the boys usually drew me as a skeleton or something horrible like this. And also I grew up in a very poor family. Well, you can't even, it was half of a family. My mother raised us alone. My little sister was born with cerebral palsy and deep case of autism, so it was specifically hard for me to feel pretty, because when I was exposed to society, I often was sharing the place in this world with my sister, and it was difficult to sort of walk around feeling proud, smiling, and because this was not really my reality. My reality was not really about beauty. I was living in a grayest area of my hometown, Nizhny Novgorod, and I was surrounded by misery and poverty and alcohol and abuse and aggressivity. This is my past. However, when I got this, I was scouted to be a model. It was kind of incredible at the time. But I, when I first came to Paris, I was a very different person than I am today. I was much more aggressive. I saw that everyone wanted to take advantage of me. I was very defensive. I was not very nice. And then I was very lucky that I, by changing my environment, first of all, I ended up in Paris. It was the first place I arrived, so I was suddenly surrounded by beauty. I was so impressed by people and women on the street being so chic, so simple as well, not in the same way as kind of idea of being beautiful was in my country. A lot of makeup and sort of, you know, tight dresses and actually it was about being more full, voluptuous woman. And here I was in Paris, I was kind of sharing this new platform where I could discover and knew myself. And most importantly, I met really wonderful people who taught me very simple things that told me, you know, Natalia, you have a different opportunity now. You are in Europe, no one wants to take advantage of you, no one wants to use you. We actually really like you and we want to help you. And actually one thing that would really help you to discover this and to feel this is smile to people. And it was really, really kind of, I know it's, and I used to, you know, I smiled when I was in the environment of people I like this, so you have a lovely smile, you know, you should use that more often. And don't be afraid to smile. You seem to be always afraid to smile. And in fact, in my country, we say that if you smile without a reason, you're stupid. So I grew up with this idea that, you know, I can't just come up to someone and smile to them because they'll think I'm stupid. So, you know, this is what we were talking about, the cultural differences. And I see you hear that preconceived ideas about Russia that we all kind of, you know, a little moody, a little grim. And somewhere this is maybe our cultural differences. We are changing today. And anyway, I went out and started trying it out and smiling to people. And it was incredible how it really shaped my life in a very different way. Suddenly I felt that my smiles were answered back and I had completely different a different life, and it's not that I changed at all on inside. I was always the same, and I think I remained the same until today. However, it's just I attracted different kind of people to me, and we today we speak and yesterday I hear so much about social business, about making ourselves better, about being better leaders, about having better habits. And to me, everything unites in this. It's we want to be more beautiful in one way or the other. And this is, we were earlier talking with Hans, who is from Germany, who works with Professor Yunus, and he's we were talking about something different on beauty, and he said to me, you know, beauty means in German it means to take care. And I said, really? This is so strange, because have Dostoevsky ever lived in Germany? And he said, oh yes, very much so. And another one of my colleagues from Russia said, oh yes, he did live in Germany, that's right. And you know, Dostoevsky's most famous phrase is, beauty will save the world. Well, I think that that's what it is. It's taking care of the world. That's probably what he meant, that will save it, that if each one of us will find that power within us to save the world in a way. And I know Fatima said we can't save the world with words and definitely not one person, and I agree with that. All, of course, it has to be all together, but I found that very interesting. So anyway, back to smiling. It's really by creating this this sort of different environment around myself, I started looking at life very differently and doing very different things eventually as well. So this is how I used in a way my industry and the success that it brought me to create Naked Heart Foundation. But I think that really beauty is what I want to really communicate today is, and why I would like to share this place with all the other women, is that especially who are sitting on the stage today, that each one of you is very, very beautiful, because I believe in the beauty on inside much more than on outside, and what we do and what we say as well is very, very important tools and power. So Thank you.
C'est bien ça.
Thank you, Natalia, and thank you for your beautiful smile. Actually, taking care is an excellent transition to our next counselor. Our next counselor is Caroline Miles. She's a child of Pittsburgh, so she's back in her hometown.
Yeah.
And she's also the CEO of the NGO Save the Children, and we're going to talk a bit more about taking care. But Caroline, first, Spider-Man has a question for you.
لماذا باعتقادك النساء تندفع نحو العمل في المنظمات الإنسانية؟ وهل النساء تنجح أكثر في إدارة هذه المنظمات؟ سامية الزبيدي، فلسطين.
So, first of all, I'm acutely aware that I stand between you and dinner. So, I'll try to keep my comments short. But the first thing I wanted to say is that I have to admit to you that I am not a superhero. But I actually know a lot of superheroes. And I'll tell you a few things about a couple of them. So, one is a mother who lives in Nepal. She has 5 children. And she raises her family on less than $2 a day. That's a superhero. Another is a woman named Madaletso, who lives in Malawi, who had 2 children, 2 twins. She lost one of the children in childbirth because she had no one there to help her give birth. And she became a child frontline health worker so that no mom would ever go through what she went through. That's a superhero. You heard a lot from Fatima about Malal, and there are many girls in the world today that don't have the opportunity to go to school. And they are obviously, those that stand up for that right are real superheroes. So, those are really, I think, some of the superheroes that are out there right now, and they are all girls and women who are choosing to make a huge difference. And one of the things I want to talk about is how that's really something that's going to change the world. Because if you look at what's happening around the world, this whole idea that half of the population would essentially go to waste by not having the opportunity to be everything they could be. That's what's really going to change the world. There is a huge, huge ability, and every one of you in this room, whether you're a man or a woman, actually have the ability in what you do every day to make sure that those opportunities happen. And I know that there's also a bunch of you in this room that can do something about this issue for many women who will never have the chance. So 40% of the workforce globally are women. 50% of the economy money is spent by women, but they own 1% of the world's wealth. 1%. So if that's not inequality, I'm not quite sure what the definition is. That is a totally unequal world. We know some of the answers to this issue. We know that if you educate a girl, for every year after the 4th grade that you educate a girl, for every year that you keep that girl in school, there's a whole bunch of things that happen. One is that girl is going to delay when she has her first child, when she gets married, first of all, and then when she has her first child. That child is going to be healthier. That girl's whole family will be healthier. So you are really investing in the next generation when you invest in a girl. For every year that a girl stays in school after the 4th grade, you can actually look at the GDP of that country. It rises by 20% if you get girls in that country past the 4th grade, for every year after the 4th grade. So there is a huge, huge impact of really unleashing that power of girls and women. And there are many people now talking about this as a global issue, as a way to really change things. And I think to me, that second question, which was about women as leaders and do women lead in a different way? I actually don't think women lead in a different way, but I think women as change agents is a huge opportunity for the world. And I bet if you all sat here right now and you said, I know that there's probably something that I could do to unleash opportunities and potential for women, I'm quite sure that you would come up with more than one or two things that you each could do. So I really want you to think about that, because I think that is actually the major challenge that we have. I don't know how many of you watched the debates here in the United States, but when we're still talking about women in binders, I think we have some ways to go, even here in the United States. So I'm quite sure women can get out of binders and do a lot more than be in binders. So I want to encourage you all to really take this issue up. You had some great examples of different things that women bring, obviously, but what they most of all bring is the potential that they have to really, really add to their society. So I want to really encourage you all to do that. I think we have one more question.
You hear me? Yeah. So just before we go and we hear our last counselor, just one last question to Caroline. Here at One Young World, the idea is how do we turn ideas into concrete actions and how do we make things happen? Caroline was working in the fields of the private industry and was also an entrepreneur before turning into the field of NGO. So the other question, and I know you have some material you would like to share with us on how you can use business tools to actually make things happen in the NGO business.
Great, thank you. And I think it's really important for those of you that are working on social business and you're looking at how you really drive people to care. One of the things that I think we've really found is that at Save the Children is that you've got to put yourself into the way that people are acting every day. You've got to be a part of the way they act every day. So I'm going to show you a quick video. And this video is based on us going out to villages where we work in Guatemala and Malawi and recording the heartbeat of the children that we serve. And you'll see what happened to that heartbeat when you watch this video. It's a great example of getting yourself into where your supporters might be. So take a look.
This song was created with heartbeats of children in need. Find out how it can help frontline health workers bring hope to millions of children at everybeatmatters.org.
So do not hesitate to download the song online. And to conclude this session, guys, we are 5 minutes to dinner. This is the great news about it. We would like to welcome on stage a fifth counselor. She's a very young woman. She's a very successful entrepreneur. You already saw her on the Muhammad Yunus session. I'm losing my microphone, which is time to stop probably. Her name is Jessica Jackley. And please, Jessica, welcome us on stage.
Thank you. I'm going to talk fast because I think many of you are hungry. What I want to say to you tonight is this. Every woman in this room is powerful, and every man in this room is powerful too. But we have to be careful because sometimes our powers can go unused. Whatever information you might encounter here, whatever great ideas have come across today, whatever innovative strategies, none of these things matter unless you are totally and utterly convinced that you can, you have the ability, and you have the power to make your own dreams a reality. None of this stuff matters unless you're totally convinced of that. You have to believe when push comes to shove and when it's hard and when it's confusing. And someone asked earlier today, they feel maybe weary, like it's they want to give up. You have to be convinced in those moments that it's worth continuing and that you don't, you are capable of achieving your dreams. And perhaps more importantly, I believe that you have to be utterly convinced that the person sitting next to you and that every person that you encounter is equally capable of achieving their dreams too. And if you don't believe these two things, then I don't think anything else matters. Very quickly, very, very quickly, I think my story is proof of this. I grew up here too. I'm a Pittsburgh girl as well. And yeah, I grew up 20 minutes from here. And I grew up in a loving family in a very loving, supportive community that valued service. However, one of the ways that I learned about service, I think did some damage to me. I learned about the poor at a very young age, and I learned about the poor through well-intentioned NGOs, church groups, etc., that talked about people living in poverty as people who had stories only of sadness and suffering and desperation and hopelessness. And as I heard these stories over and over again throughout my life, yes, they made me feel something. They made me feel, I guess, pity and shame about my own relative middle-class American wealth. And yes, they drove me to act. But over time, I think one of the things those stories did to me was slowly build up some doubt in me that these other people in the world, people who might not have access to financial resources, it made me doubt that they could do things as great as they are all capable of doing, as we are all capable of doing. But one day, I was sitting in a classroom a lot smaller than this, not as grand and exciting as this conference, and I was listening to a speaker, just like you're doing now, and as you're doing all day. And that speaker talked to me and told me some things that totally changed the course of my life. That speaker was actually Dr. Muhammad Yunus. It was the gentleman that I got to sit next to today on this stage. And to be honest with you, I was trying to look very calm and professional, but I wanted to jump up and down because I was sitting next to one of my heroes and somebody who changed the course of my life. So this was about 9 years ago. I heard him talk about his work with the Grameen Bank, and I heard him talk about the poor in a way that was new to me. He didn't talk about people who had stories only of sadness and suffering that made me feel bad and scared and overwhelmed and afraid to even try to help. But he talked about smart, strong, hardworking entrepreneurs, intelligent people who may not have had access to schooling or resources, education, but they were doing everything right. So I saw the poor for the first time as amazing individuals completely capable of doing things as great as I thought I might be capable of doing. And it changed everything. So even though I had no special skills, no relevant education, I studied philosophy and poetry in college, never business, nothing like that until later. Even though I wasn't prepared and maybe wasn't ready in the eyes of the world, I was so inspired by Dr. Yunus that a few weeks later I quit my job. It was my first job out of college and I quit it. And I moved to East Africa for a while and I met entrepreneurs in Kenya, Uganda, and Tanzania. I wanted to see for myself who these people were. I wanted to see for myself and hear for myself their stories. And in fact, they were stories of amazing life change and of confidence and of dignity. And hearing those stories inspired me so much that I wanted to share those stories with friends and family. And I wanted to respond differently. I didn't just want to give my few dollars or throw change in a jar and go on with my day and, you know, feel better about myself because I had done something good. I wanted to really know them and stay engaged. And I thought a good way to do that would be by lending them money instead of just giving. So this little idea to stay in touch with my new friends in Kenya, Uganda, and Tanzania, and soon all over the world, and to lend them a little bit of money, $25 at a time, that tiny, tiny idea led to the creation of Kiva. And that was 7 years ago. Kiva is a peer-to-peer microlending website where you can go online and lend to anybody, lend $25 or more to anybody in need who's posted on that site, goat herders, farmers, seamstresses, all sorts of amazing entrepreneurs, and get paid back. And over just 7 years, it's not that long, Kiva has facilitated over $360 million in loans. It has grown very, very fast. And I have to pinch myself every day because it's grown. Yay, lenders. That's not my money. Yay, lenders. So this little idea grew. And it started because I was able to see and to hear and to really believe in a different story of the poor, a story of potential and capability, a story of greatness. And I was told a lot of these things before that moment in time when I heard Dr. Yunus speak, and then when I decided that I was going to really try to do my dream in the world and Kiva began. I was told a lot of the same things that maybe you're hearing now and you've heard before. And the thing that was different, if I really look back to that time, the thing that became different for me was that I decided that it was time to really start trying. I decided to give myself permission to be a superhero. Superheroes are just regular people that decided to put on a cape, right? Decided to be great, to put on their greatness, because they know the world needs them, and they're not afraid to fail. They're not afraid to just get out there and try. So that's when I decided to really start trying. I decided I wouldn't let my own story be anything less than the very best version of my story. And I decided that to make sure through Kiva and the other work that I'm trying to do in the world, that I wanted to help everyone else have access to the resources that they needed and to tell their own story of greatness so that they could reach their potential too. So, to close, I believe everybody here has superhero potential, every single one of you. So whatever you do, as you go throughout this conference and before you leave tonight, promise me that you will decide right now, not 5 minutes, but right now, decide that you will not doubt yourself, that you won't doubt the person sitting next to you. And if you decide this, if you decide to believe that you are capable of making world-changing positive impacts in the way that only you uniquely can do, and if you remind the person next to you that they can do that too, I promise you, that person by person, interaction by interaction, as you go through your days, we will make this world a drastically different and much better place together. Thank you.
That was an amazing and inspirational session, so a huge round of applause and thank you to Adeline, Emmanuel, and all the counselors. Thank you. Yeah, sure. So, what a day, huh? Most amazing stuff. I mean, we pack it all in because we only do this once a year, so we make you work extraordinarily hard and do huge amounts of things, and this is only day one. We have two more days to go. Kate is going to come up with some housekeeping announcements. I want to thank you all for the energy, for the inspiration, for the ideas. I think every year we do this, it gets bigger and better and more exciting. Key reminder, you know, if there's things you saw today that you thought, I really care about that, go and do something about it. You know, it's tangible action that we're looking for. We start tomorrow at 8 a.m. So let's make sure we have a bang on time start, because as you see, the later we start, the later the days go on. What else do we have to say by way of housekeeping, Kate?
I just think to know that tomorrow morning, as David said last night about your being here, you are lucky to be here. There are lots of people who wanted to be here in your stead. I know you'll be tired. You do have to get here at 8 o'clock, okay? It's just not cool to come drifting in at 9:30 because you're too lazy to get up, okay? Deal? Yeah? Special time, make the most of it, okay? And if you don't get up, you are going to be woken up. Someone's going to come and knock on your door. Yeah? It's my mommy placement. It's like your mom
comes. The name badges all have an RFID tag inside them, so we know exactly where you are.
Oh, hello. So, when you go out tonight, at the information desk, there is a flyer like this, okay? And you need to pick it up because this is just fabulous. So, the Pittsburgh Cultural Trust have put this evening on for you. And it's across Liberty Avenue, Penn Avenue, Fort Duchesne, 7th Street, 9th Street, 7th Street, and 8th Street. And that's what they call the Pittsburgh Cultural District. And they've specially put this evening on for you. So I'll just give you an example of some of the things. At the Fairmont Hotel, there's jazz at the downstairs bar in the lobby, Andy's from 8 o'clock till midnight. The backstage bar and cabaret at Theatre Square, there's an exhibition of Pittsburgh City Landscapes, and it's also Salsa Friday. And you get a free dance lesson from 10 till 10:30.
What happens if 1,300 people all go to the same place?
No, listen. One Young World, the music, there are different DJs until 1:30 tomorrow morning. Whoa, getting up. But you can get in free as long as you've got your ID pass. At Katz Plaza, there's a walking tour of the city that starts at 8:30 tonight. There's dancing. There are other art. They're just so good. There's a cell phone disco at Bocca Court and food trucks. You can play a game of Bocca. You get late night snacks. There are films showing. So if you just look at everything that's on there, I'm sure whatever your interests, there are wonderful things, and it's all free. So have your passes on you. You can get some food, you can have a dance, you can look at some art stuff. So please take advantage of this, because they've done a wonderful job, and I know they want to show their city off.
And we will see you at 8 o'clock, and give yourselves a huge round of applause. Thank you.